reading from the book of Revelation. I, John, heard a voice saying to me, "Behold, I am coming soon. I bring with me the recompense I will give to each according to his deeds. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the first and the last, the beginning and the end. Blessed are they who wash their robes so as to have the right to the tree of life and enter the city through its gates. I, Jesus, sent my angel to you this testimony for the churches. I am the root and the offspring of David, the bright morning star. The Spirit and the bride say, 'Come.' Let the hearer say, 'Come.' Let the one who thirsts come forward, and the one who wants it receive the gift of life-giving water. The one who gives this testimony says, 'Yes, I am coming soon.' Amen. Come, Lord Jesus." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
For our parish community here. And we pray that all of them may experience great joy in their ministry and hopefully bear great fruit for the kingdom of God. Now, regarding St. Stephen, he was not only among the first seven deacons in our church's history, but he's also considered the first church martyr. And he was very passionate about promoting the gospel, which, as you can imagine, did not set well with the local Jewish authorities, who led him to a sentence of death by stoning. Stoning, as you may know, was one of the main forms of capital punishment back then among the Jewish people for those who committed things like adultery. As you may recall in John's Gospel, chapter 8, when Jesus saved the adulterous woman from that stone-wielding mob, and for the offense of blasphemy, which means using offensive language to or against or about God. Now, going around claiming Jesus as Messiah on the same level as God, well, that's punishable by death in those days. And that's what St. Stephen proclaimed courageously. Yet what's more amazing about St. Stephen's story here is how he handled his death sentence. He knew he was innocent. He stood up for what was right. However, in the process of accepting his fate, just as Jesus did in his innocence, Stephen invoked a power stronger than any human force, the power of the Holy Spirit, and that enabled him to forgive. Remember the verse we heard from the Acts of the Apostles, and I quote, "As they were stoning Stephen, he called out, 'Lord Jesus, receive my spirit. Do not hold this sin against them.'" Where have we heard that before? Well, that's a parallel to what Jesus said while on the cross, right? "Father, forgive them. They don't know what they're doing. Father, into your hands I commend my spirit," right? And that emphasizes the central importance that forgiveness has in our Christian life, since Jesus came into the world to forgive and heal sinners with his loving mercy. So this is one of the main things that distinguishes Christians from non-believers: the ability to forgive another person for whatever wrongs someone did, even if it's murder. Now, you may recall the old Christian hymn that we've sung here many times before, "They'll know we are Christians by our love," right? That's an oldie but goodie. What greater way to show God's love than to forgive somebody, even if the person doesn't deserve it, even if the person isn't sorry for the wrong they've done? Isn't that what Jesus showed when he died on the cross for us? Even though we, as sinners, did not deserve such a gift, we deserve to be punished for our sins. You know, a great modern-day example of this forgiveness concerns a powerful story I heard in the year 2000 at our annual convocation. Convocation is the annual gathering that we priests in the diocese have with our bishop. We had a guest speaker that year by the name of Bud Welch, who lost his daughter Julie on that infamous day of April 14, 1995, when the federal building in Oklahoma City was bombed. And Bud told us that for the first 5 weeks of the trial of Timothy McVeigh and Terry Nichols, he was so enraged over what they did that he, quote, "wanted them to fry." To skip over the trial, put them right in the electric chair. And even though Bud Welch had been against the death penalty before, and he was a very devout Catholic, he let his emotions override his reasoning with that whole thing. And yet, as time went on, Bud realized something very important. And he said this, and I quote him from his speech: "The day they take Timothy McVeigh from his cage for the purpose of killing him won't bring back my daughter. If Jesus came back today, the first place he would go would be death row, because that's where he dwelled on his way to his crucifixion." End quote. And you know, Bud spent many years after that traveling around the country speaking out against the death penalty to honor his daughter's memory, knowing that the only way of true peace in the heart is forgiveness. He knew that forgiving was the only true way to be able to faithfully follow Jesus Christ step by step all along the way. Bud knew he couldn't forgive on his own. He had to rely on power from above. And he realized that an eye for an eye mentality just leaves more people blind to God, to his love and his mercy. I also recall the words of a very famous American we all know very well on this same subject. He offered the following insight, and I quote him: "Go to any prison and ask the inhabitants who have written shameful lines across the pages of their lives. From behind the bars, they will tell you that society is slow to forgive. Make your way to death row and speak with the tragic victims of criminality. As they prepare to make their pathetic walk to the electric chair, their hopeless cry is that society will not forgive. Capital punishment is society's final assertion that it will not forgive. End quote. And you know, those words came from a man who also had a good idea as to what Christ himself went through on death row on his way to execution on the cross. Those words came from Martin Luther King Jr. in 1963. Just 5 years before an assassin brought his life to an early end. And just like St. Stephen, Martin Luther King became a martyr for the sake of love. So what do you and I stand for? When you think back over your lives and recall the times that you were disrespected, you were insulted, and you were treated horribly or ignored, or maybe you were physically harmed, or you may recall someone hurt a person that you loved deeply, have you and I been true witnesses to the power of God's love and forgiveness through all that? Through our forgiving. When you consider what people like Jesus and Stephen and Bud Welch and Martin Luther King Jr. went through, and they were able to forgive, well, how can we not forgive offenses that people have made against us over the years? They're probably a lot smaller in comparison, aren't they? Just think of the prayer has helped bind people who are Christian together for many centuries. Prayer we use every time we come to Mass includes the line, "And forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us." Do we really mean what we say? And you know, right after Jesus finishes teaching his disciples that prayer in Matthew chapter 6, what's the very next line that Jesus says? He tells his apostles, "For if you forgive other trespasses, other people their trespasses, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. But if you do not forgive others, neither will your Father forgive your trespasses." God's going to dish out the way you dish things out. So get ready. As we go about our daily lives, especially after just having celebrated Memorial Day last week, honoring all those who sacrificed their lives for our nation and the cause of freedom around the world, just remember the ultimate sacrifice that Jesus made for all of us, for the sake of love and forgiveness, and live out that same spirit.
Father and Son. that all nations, especially the U.S. and Iran, may reconcile by resolving their disagreements peacefully and grow in working together and finding common ground, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our
prayer. That all of us and all Christians may serve as stronger witnesses of Christ's forgiving love and mercy for our examples of showing love and forgiveness to others, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all our newly ordained deacons and priests, especially Father Matthew Walter and Father Daniel White, who became priests for our diocese yesterday morning, that their labors and ministry may be effective in spreading the good news of salvation in Christ, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That the church, wounded by its many divisions, may someday soon become one as Jesus prayed for through respectful dialogue and steadfast prayer, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That those who have difficulty to forgive others or themselves may be empowered by the Holy Spirit to do so, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That those who suffer from physical or mental illness may experience divine healing and peace, especially Gary Schick, John Memora, Lori Schaefer, and all those listed in our bulletin and in the prayer book of requests, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That our deceased loved ones may rest eternally in God's heavenly peace, especially Charles Michaels, Christian Waite, Mary Bora, and Mary Lou Grohl, our special intention, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For any prayers you offer now in silence, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
We also like to pray for the victims of the mass shooting at Virginia Beach back on Friday, that the dead may rest in peace, the wounded may be healed. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Glorious God, you invite us to share in your unity. Hear these prayers, which we humbly lift up to you, and keep us always on your path to everlasting glory. We ask all this through Christ, our Lord.
Amen. Amen.
Our hymn for the presentation of the gifts is number 932, One Bread, One Body, number 932.
Oh,
Pray, my brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, our Almighty Father.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice at your hands for the praise and glory of his name, for our good and of all of his holy church.
Accept, O Lord, the prayers of your faithful with the sacrificial offerings, that through these acts of devotedness we may pass over to the glory of heaven through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
And lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just that we should always give thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, for you do not cease to spur us on to possess a more abundant life, and being rich in mercy, you constantly offer pardon and call on sinners to trust in your forgiveness alone. Never did you turn away from us, and though time and again we have broken your covenant, you bound the human family to yourself through Jesus, your Son, our Redeemer, with the new bond of love so tight that it can never be undone. Even now you set before your people a time of grace and reconciliation, and as they turn back to you in spirit, you grant them hope in Christ Jesus and a desire to be of service to all, while they entrust themselves more fully to the Holy Spirit. And so, filled with wonder, we extol the power of your love, and proclaiming our joy at the salvation that comes from you, we join in the heavenly hymn of countless hosts, as without end we acclaim. Spirit, as they partake of this one bread and one chalice, they may be gathered into one body in Christ who heals every division. Be pleased to keep us always in communion of mind and heart, together with Francis our Pope and Salvatore our Bishop. Help us to work together for the coming of your kingdom, until the hour when we stand before you, saints among the saints in the halls of heaven, with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, St. Joseph, her spouse, the blessed apostles, St. Stephen, St. Paul, St. Benedict, and all the saints, with our deceased brothers and sisters, whom we humbly commend to your mercy, and freed at last from the womb of corruption, and made fully into a new creation, we shall sing to you with gladness the thanksgiving of Christ, who lives for all eternity. Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever.
Table song 923.
Body of Christ. Body of Christ. Remain seated for a moment for a special presentation. This weekend we're honoring our graduating high school seniors, and we have a parting gift for them. So if you are graduating from high school within a couple of weeks, we invite you to come forward. We have something to offer you. Anyone wishing they were graduating seniors would also probably be a blessing instead. Leave the camera where for one second. Thank you. John and Phoebe, please know that your faith community has tenderly cultivated the seeds of your faith over the years. And we want to give you some simple reminders of the love and support that we extend to you as you begin the next chapter of your life's journey. So we offer this blessing to you and these gifts as a reminder both of the love of your community and God's love for you. As you use this soap, never be afraid to get your hands dirty in service of others. As you use this toothbrush and toothpaste, please remember your smile is a gift from God which you can share daily with everybody. And I mean everybody. As you use this highlighter, may it remind you to receive the Eucharist to emphasize the constant presence of God's love in your life. As you cleanse your hair with this shampoo, never forget that God loves you so much that every hair on your head has been counted. He prefers clean hair too, especially my hair. As you comb your hair, may you find strength to use the gifts the Spirit has given you. Don't worry, it's somewhere in there. It is our prayer that your troubles and tears will be few, but know that these tissues and first aid kit and band-aids are a reminder that God's healing love is always with you. And may this pen and these index cards be a reminder of God's living word. And as this magnetic clip holds your papers, may it remind you to cling to your faith and the sticky notes to hold tight to your beliefs. And as you quench your thirst with this water bottle, may it remind you of the waters of your own baptism, which firmly placed you in the hands of God. And as you venture out of our community, please know that our Blessed Mother Mary is always with you, as is the love of this faith community. May the seed of your faith blossom and bear much fruit. And God bless you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. How about a nice hand?
Sin a New Church, number 743. Please join us.